Welcome everybody to our second edition of our online session in Glass We Trust. The topic of our today's webinar is the integrated glass-based electro-optical platform for co-packaging. First, I'd like to talk a bit about the current challenges regarding interconnections and future solutions that have derived from the industry and community. And within these solutions utilizing co-packaging, I will present you our vision, which is based on a low-cost platform using thin glass, which you can see here in the background, where we have red light coupled into integrated optical waveguides. Besides these waveguides, there are also further necessary key building blocks that I'd like to talk about. But first, let's start with the question why we actually need new interconnect solutions. So as you can see here in the left graph, the global internet traffic is growing exponentially, and it is expected to reach nearly 400 exabytes per month by 2022. And this is driven by many different applications, most and foremost video streaming. And what is important to highlight is that there's much more traffic inside the data center that need to be processed and analyzed than there is traffic to and from the data center. So with the numbers here on the right side from reports from Cisco, we get a ratio of 2.5 for internal traffic in the data center to traffic from outside the data center. And to get a feeling, in the case of the data center from Facebook, this ratio is even 25. So with this in mind, we can draw the conclusion there is an increasing demand on higher data rates and data center interconnect bandwidth that need to be met. So how do we do this? We could simply increase the I/O data rate in the data center network infrastructure, but there we encounter a problem regarding the electrical interconnects. They show physical limitations such as signal attenuation and inter-symbol interference from dispersion that become really significant at higher frequencies. And this, of course, can be combated with additional equalization. But here we have the trade-off of higher energy consumption, and beyond the signaling rate of 40 gigabit per second, this kind of equalization becomes prohibitively energy expensive due to limitations of the underlying CMOS technology node. So as a result, electrical interconnects are facing a bottleneck in keeping pace with the data center bandwidth and energy consumption requirements. So that's why we really need optics, as they show superior performance compared to the electronic counterpart, as it's shown in these two graphs, especially for data travels over distances ranging beyond on-chip scales to off-chip, internode, and interreg. The bandwidth and the data movement energy provided by optical interconnect is much, much better. So on some level of the data center infrastructure, optics plays already a huge part, especially at the link level, where they use pluggable transceiver modules. And so far, the optics can keep up with the increasing data center traffic in the last year. So when the pluggable modules were first introduced into the data center, they started at 10 gigabit per second and moves then to 40 gigabit per second, and then from 40 to 100 gigabit per second, which is currently the standard in the data center. And in the near future, upgrade to 200 gigabit and 400 gigabit will happen for the next generation data centers. And even concerning 800 gigabit, there's a consensus in the industry that there will still be pluggable modules. But beyond that, we are seeing constraints to this, and different solutions are needed for several reasons. So if we look at an Ethernet switch capable of 25 terabit per second in combination with 800G pluggable modules, we would need additional retimers on board, which will increase the cost and power dissipation. And you also have the physical error limitation of the front panel of the data center switch, which means that you can only fit there that many transceiver modules as space is available. Another really important issue is the thermal management, which in case of the pluggable modules is far from ideal, because you're basically getting the heat from the plugged-in modules onto the switch ASIC and vice versa. So a solution that was proposed in the community is to move the optics from the switch front panel onto the motherboard or placing the optics directly with the ASIC in the same package. And that is what we call co-packaging. In the last year, companies such as Intel, Lenovo, and Rockley have already shown such co-packaged switch demonstrator, which you can see here on the right, and also some numbers below, like at how what kind of data rate they're operating. And these two demonstrators already showed that co-packaged optics can be done, and it can meet the requirement to address the requested network bandwidth scalability for the future. So in these kind of co-packaging integration approach, usually an interposer is used to provide the connectivity between the photonic chip and the switch and the front panel. And glass is an excellent material choice for such an interposer. As you can see here and also later on in the slides, it can meet all the optical and electrical requirements. As on the one hand, it has a wide optical transparency and shows low optical losses, especially in the typical telecommunication wavelength range, so the O and the C band. And being an insulator, it has low electrical loss, particularly at high frequencies, so it is well suited for high frequency applications. The relative high stiffness and ability to adjust the CTE, the coefficient of thermal expansion, gives advantage to manage warp and glass cross substrate and bonded stacks. And one important figure of merit in all these kind of consideration, especially for the data center vendors, is of course the cost optimization. So glass here gives an advantage for developing cost-effective solution, as it is itself considerably cheap as a material, and it is directly produced in panel format. So it is available in large sizes, which gives the opportunity to optimize current manufacturing methods. Additionally, it has a high dimensional stability in terms of temperature and time, and can strongly benefit from the steady development in the display market, where they use thin glass for such things like foldable smartphones and wearables. So there are in principle many essential parts in such a co-packaged system, and today I want to focus on three key building blocks for such an interposer. One, which is highlighted here as number one, is the electrical interconnect from the ASIC to the chips. And the other two are the optical interconnect from the photonic chips via integrated waveguide circuits in the interposer to a fiber interface, which can provide the connectivity from the interposer to the front panel. So let's take a look at the first key building block. What you need is an electrical connection between the ASIC and the photonic chip. And this you can, for this you can create a redistribution layers. And this can be done on the backside and the front side of the glass. And the manufacturing equipment we're using here allows us to create high density multi-layers with 2 micrometer line space, which is important, especially if you think of integrating devices such as an ASIC having high pin count. Additionally, passivation layers and UBM processes can be applied to provide the connection between the chips and the interposer by means of micro solder bumps and copper pillars. Besides the RDL, we also use the metallization processes on glass to create fiduciary marks, which helps later on for precise alignment of electrical and optical components. So on the top right, you see such an RDL. And on the left side here, this is not really an RDL, but rather an example to show that we can also reinforce our metal layers by means of plating the metal layers with different metals such as gold, silver, nickel, or copper. To have vertical connections for DC as well as RF, we are using TGVs, which can be completely hermetically filled as seen in the picture in the middle. And they are also optimized for electrical routing with reduced parasitics. So what we have done here, what you can see here on the slide, is a glass interposer demonstrator kit, where we created test designs for high frequency testing and material parameter extraction for the TGVs in order to leverage glass for many RF and interposer applications. And as you can see in the table here in the middle, the TGVs show excellent performance even at high frequencies, so they can provide large bandwidth and improve the RF performance drastically. Furthermore, thermal cycle testing were done regarding the electrical functionality and thermal and mechanical reliability, and they show that there is no significant performance degradation or no cracking or delamination can be seen in the TGVs. One drawback of using glass, which is known, is of course the low thermal conductivity. However, the metallized TGVs can be used as heat pipes to allow controlled heat transfer from components on top of the interposer to heat sinks. And this is especially critical when increasing the density of photonic and electronic components to bring them as closely together as possible and simultaneously increase the number and speed of ports. So the low intrinsic thermal conductivity of glass can be converted into an advantage in this way. And this is an ongoing development at Fraunhofer ITM. Regarding the second key building block, the fiber interface, we need efficient access from optical fibers to the on-chip photonic system. And that is the key challenge for many different materials. The main approaches that are used to couple to photonic chips are either edge coupling or grating coupling. They both have advantages and disadvantages, like edge coupling provide a large spectral bandwidth but require sub-micrometer alignment, as well as spot size converters due to the mismatch in the mode of field size. And grating coupling can provide wider alignment tolerances but has the disadvantage of a narrow spectral bandwidth. So in many proposed co-packaged solutions, as you can see in the picture on the top left, the PICs are generally designed, or the fiber connectivity is designed by means of coupling the light from the optical fiber directly to the PIC. And what we propose is rather, instead of coupling to all the PICs individually with optical fibers, which is of course a lot of packaging effort and that means a higher cost, we put the fiber interface directly at the interposer, and the coupling to the PIC can be done by evanescently coupling out of plane from the integrated waveguide to the PIC. So in terms of assembly, you have a combined bonding process for electrical and optical connection to the PIC. For the fiber interface at the interposer, we are pursuing two solutions. One is based on edge coupling, which you can see on the left picture, where we have derived a pluggable connection solution for mechanical and optical coupling of single mode fibers based on standard multi-fiber connectors, such as the MTP connector. So the idea basically here is that we use a precisely manufactured MT-style connector that can be assembled in the glass interposer. And it is designed in such a way that when you align the optical fibers to the integrated waveguide, all the degree of freedoms are minimized while the alignment accuracy, which is required for single mode operation, is still kept. So this kind of connector is compact and robust and compatible with standard manufacturing techniques and can be implemented with standard automation tools. The typical coupling loss we achieve here is below 1 dB per interface. And in this picture here, the connector is made by EDM manufacturing, but it is also possible to realize it completely in thin glass using a green laser, which gives you a much higher reliability because the connector has the same CTE as the glass sheet. Another approach which is currently under development is called gradient index surface coupling, which you can see on the right side, and that we have presented last year at the ECTT conference. And here we make use of the physical principle of Grignard lenses, which is sketched here in the middle. So if a Gaussian beam is eccentrically coupled into such a Grignard lens, the light image is mirrored to the diagonal axis halfway the pitch. So when the light beam is entering this lens, it is first expanded, and when it enters the lens, it is focused, but shift upwards. So this kind of principle can be also realized using two glass sheets with half mirror inverted refractive index profile of such a lens, which you can see here below. And this gives us the opportunity to directly couple light from the lower glass to the upper glass with high alignment tolerances, because at the level where you align the two glass sheets, the beam is expanded. So we have done numerical simulations confirming this, And as you can see on the right side, we have alignment tolerances in the range of micrometers and higher. So this is a good thing. And another important difference to other coupling scheme is that when we use the GIST approach, we are flexible in wherever we want to place the connectors. So we can place it near the edge of center poser, the same for the edge coupling, but we can also place it anywhere on the surface of the interposer. So this gives us some flexibility in the optical design of the waveguide circuits. For the optical interconnection from the PIC to the front panel, we integrate single mode waveguide into the glass interposer, and they show excellent performance. So we have really low propagation losses, a low polarization dependency. And one important aspect that distinguished glass is that it shows a large optical bandwidth. So in the future, I think we will also see new standards and MSA that are aiming at different wavelengths for optical transmission in the data center than we have now. So there we already have an advantage for future applications. In the left side, you can see 12 parallel 2 meter long spiral shaped waveguides that are integrated in a glass sheet, the size of 273 times 227 millimeter, and they're nearly covering the whole glass. And this was done in order to evaluate the homogeneity of the underlying processes to create these waveguides. And all these waveguides in there show really low standard deviation in terms of propagation losses. So this gives us proof of the functionality and reliability of the underlying process. Furthermore, that also enables us to get a high yield and therefore reduce the manufacturing costs, but also allows us to scale further up to larger sized glasses for panelization and the use of multi-project panels. As maybe not everyone is familiar with the manufacturing of optical waveguides integrated in glass, let me briefly show you the main step of the fabrication process. So we start in the beginning with a sheet of glass from a commercial glass supplier and cut it to the respective format we need using a CO2 laser. Then, based on phototolithography, we transfer a laser wooden layout to a metal mass to create a diffusion mass for the ion exchange process, which you can see at step 3. The whole board is dipped into a molten salt bath containing silver ions, and these change places with sodium ions of the glass and make a well-defined refractive index distribution with the maximum refractive index at the surface. So this is basically our optical waveguide. To further bury the waveguide into the glass, we do a so-called reverse ion exchange process where silver ions move further into the glass, and at the same time, silver ions that are really close to the surface are replaced with sodium ions from the molten salt. So we get a refractive index distribution, which you can see at 0.6. Finally, the glass sheet can be depanelized using, again, the CO2 laser from the beginning. And here it's critical to mention that this leaves the surface of the side of the glass with a high optical quality, so no further polishing is needed if you want to connect it to optical fiber. The whole process uses standard commercial equipment, which is highly suitable for automation and can be easily integrated into existing production lines, but it's also compatible with mid-scale production using batch processing. Besides the optical redistribution with integrated waveguides from the photonic chip to the fiber interface, we are currently developing an extensive library of integrated components so that we can create flexible off-chip network architecture with passive and active functions. So some of these are already established, some of them are in development, and you can use these devices for creating spot size converters, for power splitting to change the phase or polarization of the propagating light. And this is, of course, not only aiming at use cases such as in glass interposer for terabyte switch, but also offers a wider application range, such as sensors, quantum devices, and many more. To not only show you pictures of single components or building blocks, but also fully assembled systems, we have here the outcome of a publicly funded project, which is already completed. There we have developed a hybrid integrated interposer for data communication at a wavelength of 850 nanometers. And this is not exactly co-packaging, but it shows our capability of packaging and assembly in terms of optical sub-assembly of transmitter and receiver chips. So here's a glass interposer with TGVs that was used as a carrier for flip chip mounted VCSELs, photodiodes, and driver ICs. The IF routing on the last interposer was optimized for data rates up to 20 gigabit per second per channel. And furthermore, the interposer has also integrated waveguards for the optical routing and has integrated lenses for beam shaping so that we have an optimized optical design with reduced losses of down to below 0.5 dB for the receiver side and below 2 dB for the transmitter side. One big advantage here was the possibility to cool the components from the top with heat spreaders, because conventionally optical, electrical, and thermal path are always on the same interposer side. The key building blocks I have shown on the previous slide are, as I already mentioned, realized using commercial equipment. And this is designed for large panel sizes. So any process or technology that we are developing, no matter how small the typical sample size we start with in the beginning is, we can upscale the whole process. So for example, all the machines displayed here are needed for the manufacturing of glass integrated waveguides. And nearly all of them are designed for full format panel size. So that means a size of 610 millimeter times 457 millimeters. Only the diffusion chamber on the most right side, which we need for our ion exchange process, is self-made. So we have some flexibility in-house, but also this is currently upgraded to handle full panel size. And why do I mention this? And why is it important to go into panel level and using this kind of hardware is that it allows to drastically reduce photonic packaging manufacturing costs. And this is important because the market currently is under extreme price pressure. So technologies that reduce the cost are highly valued. So here we have performed a baseline cost analysis exercise on the impact of co-packaging. And as an example, on the left side, you see the cost breakdown for conventional 400G transceiver module with cost input such as module assembly, other packaging materials and components, including the laser and electronic. And what makes nearly half of the total manufacturing cost are the optical subassemblies, including the PIC and electrical optical IOs. And all of these processes are typically performed at the package level. So if you compare this to a co-package approach, you realize the cost inputs are significantly lower. So all the transceiver module integration and packaging is performed at the panel level on a common glass interposer. And based on the design you can see below with 8 satellite transceivers and one ASIC in the middle, we estimate that there is a cost reduction potential for the optical subassembly of 20 times. So this really underpins the potential of co-packaging itself, as well using glass-based platform for future co-packet switches. So to summarize, we have seen that co-packaging will be required eventually at some point, as there is a market need and the market makers are pushing for it. And here we have seen that we can use glass as an electro-optical platform for co-packaging, as it is already a very mature technology at Fraunhofer ICDM with highly developed electrical and optical interconnects, and also offers a low-cost solution that is compatible with processes and equipment for high-volume manufacturing. With this, I'd like to end my presentation and thank you for your attention. I hope that you stay in contact with us and visit our future webinars of our series in Glass We Trust, the next one focusing on the automated assembly of thin glass-based optical systems. For right now, I'm happy to answer questions in the live discussions, or you can also, of course, contact me or Henning Schröder per email anytime after the webinar. Thank you very much.